Okay, decisions in the age of digitalization. So, to make one thing very, very clear at the very beginning, most important human decisions can and will never be automated. Right? They are done by gut feeling under extreme uncertainty. Right? And I'm not going to talk about these. So don't blame me on that. These 0% automation on decisions like, these are examples from my life, marrying my wife, declining a tax-free permanent CERN job offer instead of a KIT professorship, or founding Blue Yonder. So in retrospective, these were all very good decisions, but it's not clear beforehand, right? So I'm not talking about these things. But I claim that 99% of all operational decisions in enterprises can be automated. And they will be automated, and they will be also simultaneously improved by quite some margin. Right, so, and I'm going, that is where I'm going to report on. So, and these are especially repeated, regularly repeated, similar decisions. Like, let's take an example from a retail. So, assume you're a store manager and you have to decide, from this article, how many do I have to order so that I have enough tomorrow, but not too many, so that I have to throw it away then once the shelf life is gone? 10? 0, 100, right? So that's a decision many people have to do every day, right? Again and again. Or you, again, you're a store manager. Do you want to decrease this, the price of this product today? Yes, by 5%, by 10%, by 20%. That's a decision that people have to take very often. Or send this expensive catalog to that customer or to that customer. Is it worthwhile? Will it be good for him? Will it be good for us? So these are questions I'm talking about. So don't you believe the 99%? First, you have to know how most common decisions are taken in real life. And that's about something like that. So 90% of these decisions are do nothing or do what we always do, what people always have done, even before I came here. Wanted to bring into this business everything I have learned at university. So first you are told, no, we do it this way, or ever, always. Mm-hmm. 9%, about 9% apply business rules in one or the other sort. But many of these business rules are, if you really look at them, not very good. Almost none of them has a really a proof of value. And only about 1% of decisions are really something somebody sits down, uses his brain, and thinks about it. And even this 1% is even far from optimal. Right? For this, you have to know that human decision-making system has two systems. The system, so-called system one, is fast and intuitive, but it has many biases. And only and number two, system two, is slow and rational, but it is hardly used. Why? Because it's work. It takes lots of energy to use it, right? And most of the time, we don't use it. We use system one rules for everyday life. And even and especially also scientists and experts use their gut feeling after some time. They are not always thinking and rationally deciding, right? And one also very important to know, the system one, the fast one, cannot speak statistics. Right. It cannot really judge risk and chance. That's a big problem. Daniel Kahneman, Nobel Prize winner, has done research his whole life about this, how we are thinking. And this book is really very well worth reading, Thinking Fast and Slow, where all this is described, and he describes how our system one is doing decisions, and this is all explained by evolution. So it was right, right? We are here now because we did it that way, right? But there are many effects. For example, the IKEA effect. We value something higher when we worked a little bit ourselves for it. That's IKEA. And there are many such so-called cognitive biases, and it's very funny to see that also somebody like myself, who thinks is very rational, uses all or has all these biases every day. So this is simply, it is like that, we can't do anything against it. So our question was, how can we take more rational decisions than we are actually doing? And the origin of all this idea comes from CERN and KIT, so from my research work. Development is now done at Blue Yonder, and the basis is really is big data, Bayesian statistics, machine learning, data science, stochastic programming, causality reconstruction. So in other words, it is really science, how scientists work in order to get insights from data and then optimize decisions on the basis of these insights for the future. And it's a purely scientific thinking and ethos that is also not true in most enterprises, as I have learned. And we are trying to do this technology transfer to reinvent business processes with scientific methods. So this is a key. The key to better decisions in the digitalization era is data and algorithms. So first you need objective, relevant objective data. So it's mostly your data or your company's data. And you need good and correct, mathematically correct predictions for near future events on the basis of this data, including uncertainty. That's a very important point. And this is handled by an area that is called predictive analytics. Then you also want to know, if you decide this or that, what does it mean? So you need cost functions, utility functions of what is the consequence of this or that decision. And you want then to optimize this decision and using the prediction and the utility function to give a recipe of what you should do. That is called prescriptive analytics. And finally, that's the king's discipline. This, if you are so far already, then you can also automate this. And then it is done completely automatic. So when can we use predictive analytics? So it is in between purely random processes like lottery or so, and completely deterministic processes like a mechanic pendulum. Right? And most processes that we are interested in are in the continuum between it. So they are partly predictable, but there's lots of randomness and uncertainty inside. Most people think that the world is very deterministic. That's not true. Right? So there is some determinism inside, and that's our work to get this component out. Right, but there's also always lots of uncertainty inside. And evaluating the value of a decision, we also need to take into account the uncertainty. That's a very important point. So, and that is what predictive analytics can do. Going back to our store manager and his problem, how many articles to order. So there may be many, many influencing factors on how many articles will be sold tomorrow, right? From weather forecast, over price, promotion, blah, 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 day of the week, holidays, seasonality, and so on, right? And but the store manager has to take it such decisions on, or he has information on many individual events, namely many articles, many locations, and many points in time, right? So in altogether, these are then many such decisions to take. And the output of predictive analytics should be something which is not only a value, so it will never be 80 pieces, because we don't know whether 80 pieces will be sold tomorrow, but it's a distribution, right, of all the possible futures, 79, 80, 81, 82, and so on, and the output is a probability for each of the possible futures, right, a probability distribution. And if you have that for each of the single cases, then you can calculate what is the value of a decision. That's prescriptive analytics. Use the predictions to take decisions on the basis of utility functions, which are somehow known or have to be found. Right there, that is still a management decision. What is the value of this or that? Right? This is something that we have to decide what is the value, what do we want to optimize. And prescriptive applications give recipes, prescriptions for every single decision. So the answer, the recipe might be take alternative 2 by 38 tomorrow. Right? And for some well-defined tasks, the mathematical and technical complexity of the whole process of prediction and decision can already be outsourced completely, and you can buy it for some applications as a solution available on the in the cloud. And with predictive analytics, we very often can attain two mutually exclusive goals. That's very interesting because that's usually in management decisions you cannot do it. For example, you can, for purchase order optimization, you can have an increased availability during the season and simultaneously reduce the rest at the end of the season, for example, in fashion retail. Or you can reduce the out-of-stock rate in your meat shelves, but simultaneously you can reduce the meat waste at the end of the shelf lifetime. Right? Or you can save 35% of your marketing budget, but still have more customers to buy your products. Right? These are examples that are possible with such technologies. We have also automated even the work of scientists, namely of my own science as a particle physicist. So we have seen that usually a PhD student or researcher has to do, he does always similar things. And once you understand it, you can also try to optimize all these. And we have found that usually a PhD thesis in particle physics can be done by 72 decisions. And they all can be optimized. And actually, this was done for one of the most successful experiments in experimental particle physics, the Bell experiment in Japan. All the data having been collected over 10 years have been reprocessed with such a program. And the output of it was 2 times as good as 400 physicists have done per hand together in 10 years. Right? So, and that was work of, yeah, machine learning or artificial intelligence and three PhD students, corresponds to about 500 normal PhD theses, and corresponds to another 10 years of data taking, which would have costed 700 million euros. Okay, so very often we have also too many decisions to be done for a human, right? For example, 130,000 articles, 5 product sizes, 3 storage locations, 2 predictions, 40 days in advance, and so on. Still, you and immediately you have some 100 million decisions. So that's always good to automate, because right, even if you give 100 million recipes, but who should read all the recipes and then decide what to do, right? And that is where we see that automation is really the ultimate goal, what we want. Right, an impact of decision automation can, for example, be seen here. So this is the out-of-stock rate at a German supermarket chain as constant at constant overall stock level as a function of time. So the original service level or out-of-stock level was about 7%. And then when the project started, they got prescriptions, and you see that the black line there, it got less. That's what we want. Right, it's good if it's small. And then suddenly, at one day, we really automated it, and no humans were allowed to do anything anymore. And then you see the result was much better and constantly better. Right, so that's the good or bad thing. Okay, so 3 examples at the end. Automatic fresh meat replenishment for supermarket chains does work very well. And so in some German supermarkets, it is done already automatically. Also, dynamic pricing in retail is something that more and more comes. In internet, it's normal already. It will also come in brick and mortar retail. It's not bad, even for the customer, right? Because a retailer can never fight against the customer. The customer has to want to come, right, and to buy. So it does not mean all the price is always higher. It just means the right price, the right time, at the right time for the right article, right? And so most retailers do not fight against the customers, but against their competitors, right? And the competitors also use methods like these nowadays. Okay, and so finally, that is another example from research. From here, collaboration of Blue Yonder and KIT. We have built such a decision system onto one chip. And this is a chip which holds now the world record in decisions. It does 8 billion decisions per second. And that is for the next generation of particle accelerators. So much data is produced in the sensors that we cannot read them out anymore. So directly on the chip, directly on the sensors, there's a chip now which decides, okay, in this event, this part of the detector of the response seems to be important, so we save it. We push it to a computer, and the others are not even read out anymore. So these are things that come, and okay, here it's very clear, here it's simply time, right? No human would have the time to do the decision. It has to be extremely fast. Okay, so all what I'm talking about here is not far future, but it is existing now, and it for sure it will further evolve. So my prediction is that quite some repetitive, routine work, but also white-collar work, right? So it's not only the workers whose job will change in future, but also, like me, white-collar work will be automated. Should be afraid of it? I think no. It is normal innovation. It makes us stronger. It makes our strategic decisions stronger, more efficient, and also sustainable. I think it's a way to a better future, and I am completely convinced that it is unavoidable. It will come. We don't have to discuss. It's only the question of time. It will come, for sure. Thank you very much.